Hey everybody, welcome back to Cooking Course. I'm Chef Todd Moore. We have a very exciting episode of Cooking Course today. We're going to talk about salt. Oh, are you not as excited as I am? Salt. And I could do like 5 episodes on salt, so don't tease me. I could, but we'll keep it to 1 because salt is, this is an up and coming trend in culinary, different gourmet salts. Now, cooking method certainly is what I always believe in, but it's amazing what you can finish at the end of your dish. And people always ask me in our cooking classes here, well, how much oregano did you put, or how much thyme, or how much seasoning? And I always tell them, it doesn't matter. You like the seasoning, put the seasoning in. You don't like the seasoning, don't put it in. It is the artist's final signature on the bottom of his dish, is how you season your dish. And it's the same thing with salts here. So if you'll indulge me a little bit, we'll talk about different types of salts, red salts, black salts, gray salts, and the difference between them. Now, salt has been cultivated since before 6000 BC in China, and salt has a wide history in the human beings. They have found it in pyramids in Egypt. It was a funeral offering. Salt was very dear back then. Salt was like currency, was like money. It is so dirt cheap now. It's salt cheap. That's the new phrase that we should use. Salt cheap. You know, most of the salt that is cultivated these days is done in mines. They are salt deposits under the ground that are either mined with shovels or explosives or backloaders or things like that. The other way that they do it, though, is with high pressure hoses and water, and what they do basically is dissolve the salt, pump it out of the mine, and then evaporate it to get the resulting salt. This is a little bit easier for them. But you know what? Of all salt that is mined all over the world, only about 10% or less is used for food salt. The majority of it is used for industrial purposes. It winds up on your roads when it's going to snow. It winds up in a manufacture of detergents. It winds up in manufacturers of soaps, and it sets dyes in fabrics. There are so many industries that could not do without salt. Now, the history of salt is marred with people getting killed and slavery, and in the Caribbean, it was a horrible trade because think about it, you had to find these low-lying areas that would fill with salt during the evening, and then during the day the sun would beat on it for weeks or days or months or whatever the time to evaporate the moisture, and what would be left would be salt on the beach. Who went and scraped the salt up with mosquitoes biting you and the hot sun and malaria and diseases? Well, they were slaves. They were indentured servants and slaves, and being sentenced in England, if you committed a crime in the UK and you were sentenced to the salt mines in the Caribbean, it was as good as a death sentence pretty much. So I try and have a little bit of respect for the people that have died bringing me salt. Now, not directly. Nobody died on the way to the grocery store bringing me salt, but it's a very valuable item, and it's something that's very important to chefs and to the culinary world, most certainly. Starting at this end, we have your basic iodized salt. It comes in that cylindrical container. Iodine is added to salt because there is an iodine deficiency in most human beings' diets, and a deficiency of iodine has been found leads to mental retardation and thyroid problems. So years and years ago, I think it was 50s or so, we started adding iodine to salt, and it is these small crystals that don't stick together. It's either potassium iodine or sodium iodide. It also has a non-caking quality to it, so that the crystals all stay together and doesn't cake. If you've ever had a salt shaker at the beach or at your campsite where it all sticks together, what do? You put rice kernels in there, right? Rice absorbs the liquid. Or if you get a new piece of leather or suitcase, you get these little packets of silica gel, and it always says on it, do not eat. Have you ever been compelled to try to eat one of these things? But the silica gel will act the same way if you want to keep your salt nice and dry. The next thing is kosher salt, and kosher salt is a lot more coarse. There's no iodine in it. It is a much more natural salt. I like it because it pinches really well. When I add salt to items, I run it between my fingers and it pinches very well and falls down. I rarely use iodized salt. It might be what's in my shaker because it doesn't cake and I can shake it out, but when I'm cooking coarse, kosher salt is the one that I usually use. Now, when we're evaporating water, from a an area that has locked the water in and it evaporates, what's left is the minerals in the water, and very often the minerals from that beach, from where it was lying on, and the first thing that we get out of that is a gray sea salt. You see that that's gray, much larger crystals, much harder. This is a wonderful finishing salt. This is a great salt on baked goods or pretzels or things like that. And it has a slightly mineral taste to it. Now, I know some of you are rolling your eyes and going, oh, Chef Todd, different salts have different tastes. Yet you were the one that said that you would never buy bottled water because free water came out of the tap. What are you doing now? You're buying bottled water. Trust me, this is the next big trend is gourmet salts, and you can taste the difference between an iodized salt, a kosher salt, and a gray sea salt. Secondly, this is a pink salt. It is a Bolivian salt. It is a mountain salt that is mined, and can you see the pink color on it? That's why I put it on black plates. But this is about the size of our coarse kosher salt, but it's got this really nice pink color to it, and that has to do, again, with the minerals in the water and the minerals or algae or things that are on the dirt that it is evaporating from. This has a different aroma to it. It has a different flavor to it. It's a pink Bolivian salt. Next, I have a smoked salt, and I put this on a napkin because it's black that you can't see it, and it's a finer salt. And man, if you could smell it, it smells like a campfire. It smells like the inside of a burned out wine barrel. And to me, this is amazing. And I use this salt all the time because smoking a piece of chicken breast, yeah, is pretty involved. And it's a wonderful flavor, man. I can smoke, tell you what. But at the very end, if I sprinkle some of the smoked salt on there, it gives it a very similar flavor to it. It's a quick and easy shortcut and another way to add a different depth to your meals, a different flavor profile. Oh, that smoked salt smells like a campfire. Then we start to get into red salts, and this is a Hawaiian ala'ia salt, is how they pronounce it in Hawaii, and this has to do with the minerals in the volcanic clay once again. This is what makes it red, the sea salt, and this has a much more herbal flavor to it, more flowery flavor to me, and you can see how red it is. The crystals of salt are much larger, they're irregular shaped, and this is the type of thing that I really love, and it surprises people when I make foods for them with that red salt, because the grains of salt are so large that they'll be eating and all of a sudden they bite into salt and it's kind of like, whoa, that's salty, hey, what's that flavor? It's kind of aromatic and it's kind of herbal. It's a surprise on people's palates. Different kinds of salts can add a different dimension to your meals. This is a black cypress sea salt, and this is one of my favorites. Look at how irregular all those grains are. Can you see some of them are triangular? It's like a triangular grain. Some of them are pyramid shaped. This not only gives a good salt flavor to your meals, but it gives a really good plate appeal also. It's very interesting to look at those large pyramid shaped crystals of salt on your chicken breast, and it gives it a nice color contrast, like I said, and also another, not as smoky as the alderwood, but a smoky, darker flavor of the salt. Lastly, what I've got for you is a river salt, and this is a pink river salt. This comes from, as you might expect, river water that has been evaporated, and this is almost like snow, the salt. It is very light. It is very flaky rather than crystalline, and it has its own salt flavor, and it reminds me a little bit of being out in the woods or being by a river and smelling that salty ocean water kind of thing. And I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, I mean 9 different types of salt here, and that's barely scratching the surface. There are hundreds of different types of salts. People think that there's one type of salt that comes in a canister and you shake it out in a shaker. Well, for many, many years, and I think it's only the last 50, 60 years or so that we even had salt shakers. Salt was always done in a little dish with a little tiny spoon, and if you go to your local antique store, you can probably find salt and pepper spoons and servers. It was very dear. It was not on every table. At the time, it was fine cooking. Now that I've told you about it, go practice with it and make it cooking course.